Carol called me and said she wasn't feeling well and didn't know if she'd make it or not, but we talked this afternoon about what she was going to do for Mission Mama tonight. So let me just try to tell you what she was going to do tonight. Next week begins our week of prayer for our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. That goes to our home missionaries. Ever since Mop went to be with the Lord, we've had, Bobby Carroll and I have been talking about people in our church that we kind of need to do a better job keeping an eye on every day. And she's come up with an idea called wellness checks. And she would like to meet with anybody, ladies or men, Wednesday night about 5:45. And what we're going to try to do is just try to get some names of some people that we need to check on every day. And just somebody call them every morning just to see if they're up and going and if they have any needs. Kind of like what Lifeline does if you're on a Lifeline. I think it's a good idea because I know we went by and checked on Mop, but still we just didn't have no way of knowing what was going on. So we just want to do a better job of keeping up with our church family and the needs of our church family. So anybody would like to come Wednesday night, this is a home missions ministry because it begins right here in our church. So anybody would like to come Wednesday night about 5:45, men or women, and we're going to try to get a list of names together of people that we just need to check on and call and see if they have any needs. I think it'd be a good ministry in our church. Somebody said the other day, well, we've got our deacons ministry and we've got other ministries, but this is just something we can do on top of that to make sure nobody kind of falls through the cracks, so to speak. Okay. Father, we just thank you for our missionaries, wherever they might be serving tonight. But we're getting into that time of the year where we especially pray for our missionaries that are on the home mission field. And I just lift them up tonight, wherever they might be, wherever they might be serving, whatever their needs might be tonight. We just lift them up and pray that you'd put a hedge of protection around them and physically, Father, meet their needs, but spiritually. I just pray that you'd just bless them in a supernatural way tonight. And I pray you'd encourage them and lift them up tonight so that they can keep on keeping on for you. And thank you for our church and all of our churches in the cooperative program that will play a big part in supporting our home missionaries. And I just pray, Father, that you'd just use us through our giving and through our prayers to let them know how much they mean to us and how much they mean to a lost and dying world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I meant to say this morning, and I didn't do it. There's some of you have come to me. Brother Holbert brought me a thing about two or three weeks ago. But there's a growing number of pastors, and I hear more about in Tennessee than I do anywhere else. But David Platt, who is over our North American Mission Board, I guess it's been 6-8 weeks ago, signed a thing on behalf of the North American Mission Board, also on behalf of Southern Baptists. And what it did, he was throwing our support toward building a mosque. And I don't think that we ought to be involved in that. And a lot of other pastors, I think our efforts ought to be more toward building churches. And a lot of churches have gone in and started putting their foreign mission board offerings in escrow. I think that's a little bit extreme because the ones that are getting hurt in that are our missionaries. But I have contacted David Platt and told him how disappointed I was in that. He has since... I got a letter the other day that went out to every pastor in the Southern Baptist Convention. He has apologized to every church in the Southern Baptist Convention. He's apologized to the Southern Baptist Convention. And everything said it was a wrong decision, but he will not take it back. He's going to leave his name on it. So, you know, to me, that apology doesn't go a whole long way. And I just want you all to know about that, because some of you may be, I know there's going to be an article come out in the Knoxville paper here before long, because several pastors in the Knoxville Baptist Association they're not boycotting the our co-opter program, but they're putting their money to the North American or the International Mission Board in escrow. And again, I think that's a little extreme, because it's missionaries that are getting punished for that because something their leader did. But I want you to be much in prayer for that, okay? What we're trying to do now, Jane, I mean, he's got, I think, two-thirds of the pastors in the Southern Baptist Convention have contacted him on this side. Now, he's apologized, said it was wrong, but their name is still signed to it. And that we're not giving any money to it, but it just seems like Southern Baptist Convention is supporting building of a mosque. And they're making a big deal out of it in the New York Times and other places. And it's the way it's being perceived by people. And right now we're looking into a way where we can get money to the missionaries without going through the International Mission Board. Okay, does that make sense? Okay, let me make a few announcements. I just want to make you all aware of that in case anybody heard anything about that. I know Hobart has. Two or three of you have asked me about that. If you read the Baptist Reflector, it's been big news in the Baptist Reflector. Remember Glenn Garrison. Glenn goes to the doctor tomorrow and is having a procedure. Pray for him and Helen tomorrow. Remember our service Wednesday night, and also our Sharing Jesus Without Fear. This will be our fourth session. And then Thursday night's our prayer service. We've got revival coming up March 19th through the 22nd with Dr. Mark, and we're looking forward to his coming. You got a lot of announcements in the bulletin. Make sure you read each and every one of those, okay? Anybody else got an announcement tonight? Anybody else got an announcement? Well, it's good to see everybody tonight. We're going to have a prayer and then let's fellowship one with another, okay? Father, thank you for allowing us to come tonight. And Father, I just thank you for our missionaries. And I know a lot of them have voiced their concern and disappointment over this decision that was made. But Father, we still love our missionaries and we still want to support them, pray for them. And I pray for our convention, Father. I pray for the leadership of our convention. I pray they'd make decisions, Father, that are pleasing to you, and pray you give them wisdom. Pray for leadership of our nation. Pray you give them wisdom. Build them up tonight, Father, that they might be strong for you. Father, thank you for each one that's here tonight. And again, I pray for Glenn tomorrow and for Troy's in the hospital and Misty. Carol said Misty still wasn't feeling well. Pray you'd be with her. And just got many needs tonight, but thank you that we can come into your house tonight, gather together and fellowship and worship and pray and praise you. And Father, again, it's just good to be in your house tonight. Bless us as we gather together tonight, and bless this time of fellowship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's take a minute and fellowship one with another, okay? Father, thank you tonight. One more time, we just want to praise you for who you are. Just like they thank you for letting us come back tonight. Thank you for each one who's here. Thank you for the music, Father, that you've already blessed us with. Pray you be with Bobby as she comes and sings tonight. And Father, thank you for another opportunity we have to give back to you. Pray you bless this offering. Help your kingdom to grow on this earth. Souls will be saved. And the family of God will get larger and larger and larger. In Jesus' name we pray.
Just common flesh and bones, but I'll prove someday just why I say I'm of a special kind. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. The look of love was on his face, thorns were on his head, blood was on his scarlet robe, stained a crimson red. Though his eyes were on the that day, he looked ahead in time. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. He on his mind. Yet when he was on the cross, you were on his mind.
Thank you, Bobby. I like that video. Went with it, too. Take your Bibles, if you brought them tonight, and turn with me to Acts. Acts chapter 12. And we'll be in this verse again Wednesday night, and then probably again next Sunday morning, and then we'll be in our solemn assembly next Sunday night. In Acts chapter 12, let me read verses 1 through 11. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hand to vex certain of the church, and he killed James the brother of John with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison, delivered him to the four quarterings of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. And when Herod would have brought him forth that same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers. Do you remember what it said? But prayer was made without ceasing by the church. And that same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and the light shined in the prison. He smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Rise up quickly." And his chains fell off from his hand. And the angel said unto him, "Gird thyself, and bind on thy sandals." And so he did. He saith unto him, "Cast thy garment about thee, and follow me." And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came into the iron gate that led into the city, which opened to them of his own accord. And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him. And when Peter was come to himself, he said, "Now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews." Father, we ask that you bless the reading of your word tonight. And thank you that we can come again tonight and talk about this wonderful privilege of prayer, especially what prayer means to a church and having a real heaven-sent revival. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. How many of you are familiar with the name Charles Finney? I'm sure Charles is up there. When I was at Carson Newman and we were doing a study on revivals, one of the first names that we studied was a man by the name of Charles Finney. And that name is a name that is known to anybody who has ever studied the great movements of God, the great revivals of God. In fact, Finney is sometimes called the greatest revivalist of all time, because there was no doubt that God had his hand on Charles Finney. He just was an evangelist for 7 years. But during those 7 years that he served God as an evangelist, it was estimated that there were over 500,000 people that come to know the Lord. And as always, a skeptic would say, well, a lot of that was probably of emotion. A lot of people got caught up in emotion of that time or the what was going on at that time. But years after Charles Finney died, somebody did a follow-up of those who had been reportedly saved during Finney's preaching and teaching. And years later, because he kept a card of everybody that came to know Jesus, years later when they followed up, they found that nearly 80% of the people that they were able to contact, 80% of the people who had made a profession of faith, gave evidence of a true change in their life. And I remember when we were studying Charles Finney up at Carson Newman, the teacher asked us, said, how could Charles Finney have been so effective in his ministry? What was it that caused Charles Finney to be used of God to reach so many people for Jesus? Well, after much discussion in the class, I remember he pulled out a handwritten letter. It was a copy of it. It wasn't the original, but it was a handwritten letter that Charles Finney had written to somebody talking about how God had been able to work through his life and how he gave God the glory for everything that had happened. But in writing this letter, he said, and I just want to give praise an honor to a man by the name of Daniel Nash. And our teacher said, how many people have ever heard of Daniel Nash? Wasn't anybody had heard of Daniel Nash. Very few of us had even heard about Charles Finney. But Daniel Nash was a person who Finney had come in contact early in his ministry with and noticed that this man had such an effective, powerful prayer life. So he hired Daniel Nash to become a part of his evangelistic team, his crusade team, whatever you call it, and he was just to come on and to pray. That was his sole reason for being a part of that team, just to pray. And it was said that before Finney would go into a town to preach, that Daniel Nash would go before him, sometimes 3 weeks or more ahead, and he would get him a little room in a boarding house somewhere, and then he would go out into the churches and he would try to find some prayer warriors, some people who were really committed to prayer. And then he would tell them that Charles Finney was coming to town. There's going to be a crusade. And he would get those 3 or 4 or 5 people together in that room and they would pray for 3 or 4 weeks for that crusade and for people to be saved. And he said that's the reason people were saved, because much time was spent in prayer. And it was said that once the crusade started, Daniel Nash wouldn't even go to the crusade. He would stay in that little room with those 4, 5, 6 prayer warriors, however how many it was. He would pray from morning until the crusade was over for God to work in a mighty, mighty way. One day, Finney went into a town for a crusade. And one of the women who owned a boarding house came running up to him in the street and said, Brother Finney, said, do you know a man by the name of Mr. Nash? He said, yes, he works for me. He said, well, Him and two or three men have been in my boarding house for 4 days, and they've never come out of the room. And he said, I hear sounds coming from that room. It sounds like they're beating on the floor. And she said, I went up to see what was going on and opened the door and peeped in and said they were laying on the floor on their face. And she said, I've never heard such moaning and groaning in all my life. Said, you need to go up and check on them because I'm afraid something bad has happened to them. Charles Finney looked at her and said, ma'am, you don't have to worry. She said, they're just in a spirit of prayer. We were studying Charles Finney, and our teacher said, and he showed us a picture of a neglected grave up somewhere on the Canadian border. I can't remember where it was, but there's a little tombstone grown up with weeds, and it simply says, Daniel Nash, pastor, laborer with Finney, mighty in prayer. You know, you think about a man like that, he never had the limelight. He never got the accolades. When it was talked about all these people being saved in these crusades. But let me tell you something about Daniel Nash. He was the man who shook heaven and hell when he prayed so that people would be saved. Because he believed, not just in prayer, but he believed in getting two or three people together and praying together. Folks, we need prayer meetings like that today. And we talked this morning about what a mess we're in and about the need for a solemn assembly. But how we need prayer warriors in our churches today that don't care to get on their knees, that don't care to get on their faces and do battle for lost souls and pray that God's hand would move upon our nation and pray that God's hand would move upon His church and God's hand would move upon each and every one of us as God's people. You know, in the book of Acts, we see those kinds of prayer meetings taking place. I just read about, and it didn't make much mention of the prayer meeting, just talked about the church getting together to pray, and then we read about what happened because the church got together to pray. You know, we've been asking and we've been looking at prayer these last weeks, and the last two or three Sunday nights we talked about corporate prayer, we talked about congregational prayer, we talked about coming together to pray and how important it was for the church to come together to pray. And tonight I want to share with you some powerful principles about prayer, especially prayer meetings. There were some prayer meetings in the book of Acts that literally turned the world upside down for Jesus. Tonight I'm just going to look at one principle. Wednesday night we're going to look at the other three principles, but this principle tonight, it's going to take one night to cover this first principle. The first principle of having a prayer meeting that is going to move the hand of God, that's going to stir the heart of God. And listen, I believe God's heart was stirred this morning. I really do. I believe the glory of God came down upon us this morning. But I don't think it came down upon us as mighty as He wanted it to. But the first principle of having a prayer meeting where God would literally shake us to our foundations is having a prayer meeting where everything in that prayer meeting is God-focused. Folks, too often when we come together to have church, it's not God-focused. A lot of times we're sitting in the pew and we're thinking about everything else except focusing on God. We're thinking about where we're going to go for lunch. Is the preacher going to preach so long when we get there, there'll already be a line when we get there. You know, we think about those worldly things. But folks, the first principle of a prayer meeting that's powerful is it's focused on God. We need to get focused on God in our worship, but we especially need to get focused on God in our prayer time. And we get focused on God by getting in tune with God. You know, we don't think that much today about when we think getting in tune, kids today don't really visualize that. But I can remember growing up when we just had three channels and you didn't have a remote control and you were always getting up, tuning the TV or twisting the rabbit ears and sometimes going outside and shaking the antenna that was outside just to try to get the TV in tune where you get a clearer picture. Folks, we need to get in tune with God so we've got a clearer picture of what God wants for His church and what God wants for our lives. If you did a comparison, if you did a study of the apostles in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then compared them to the apostles in Acts, you would find out that they weren't the same people. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, they approached God in a different way than they did in the book of Acts. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they were always calling on things that were not God-focused. Sometimes they were even worldly. Sometimes they called on God for things like to send down fire from heaven to consume those who had rejected Jesus. Sometimes they prayed that God would send the crowds away hungry just so that they wouldn't have to minister anymore during the day. And sometimes they even prayed for silly things like who's going to sit on the right hand and who's going to sit on the left hand of Jesus when they get to heaven. And one thing their actions show us, church, is that they had a lack of faith in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Now, sometimes they'd pray and they'd get it right. But most of the times they were way out in left field in their prayer life when it came to Jesus and when it came to the mission and the work of Jesus. But then you turn to the book of Acts and you begin to read the book of Acts and you find a completely different focus in the lives of the apostles and God's people. And you find a change even in what they're asking for. Do you realize in the book of Acts, you don't read anywhere where their faith ever failed again? And in the book of Acts, when God looked down upon a prayer meeting that they were having, sometimes 3,000 souls were saved and added to the church in a single day. Sometimes the church where they were praying was shaken. Sometimes when they prayed, prison doors sprung open. And something happened in the apostles between Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in Acts. Something happened in their prayer life. And you say, well, preacher, what happened in their prayer life? Well, it became more God-focused in the book of Acts. They began to focus on God's work and God's agenda and the mission that Jesus had and why Jesus came. Instead of being self-centered, they became God-centered. They quit seeking a seat on the left hand and the right hand of Jesus, and they began to say, what we need more than anything else, we need boldness. We need courage. We need strength. We need to go out and we need to testify because we're being persecuted. And they didn't say, deliver us from persecution, but they said, give us boldness so that when we're persecuted, we won't throw up our hands and quit. In other words, folks, they stopped thinking about their own circumstances. And they started seeking power from on high to preach the word and witness the word. They changed from being self-centered to God-centered. Church, we need to change from being self-centered and God-centered. It's not what we want, but it's what God wants. It's not our will, but God's will. In Acts chapter 4, Peter and John are released from prison. When they're released from prison, the authorities threatened them, and they said, let me tell you what's going to happen to you. If you go out and preach the name of Jesus anymore, here's what's going to happen to you. Don't speak the name of Jesus anymore. You know what they did? They went and got the church together, and they told their church what had happened. You know what the church did? They began to pray. They had prayer meetings. In Acts chapter 4, verse 24, it says, when they heard that, when they heard what the threats that had been made It said they lifted up their voice to God. Now listen to what it says. They lifted up their voice to God with one accord and saith, Lord, thou art God which made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them. Let me ask you something. If somebody come in here tonight and said the authorities are coming, they're going to arrest every one of us tonight, we need to have a prayer meeting, would we say, okay, Lord? And we'd sit down and we'd start praying by saying, and when they heard that, they lifted up their voice and said, Lord, thou God, thou hast made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them. Is that the way we'd start our prayer meeting? We'd probably start out saying, oh, woe is me, Lord. If you don't do something, we're in big trouble. But I want you to notice something after Acts chapter 4, verse 24. And you say, preacher, why are they praying a prayer like this with what's getting ready to happen? I want you to notice something in these next verses. They spend the next five verses telling God how great He is and what He's done. And then they take just two little sentences and say, God, would you give us boldness? Listen, starting in verse 24 again. When they heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, thou art God which hath made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of thy servant David is said, why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? And the kings of the earth stood up and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For a truth against thy holy child Jesus, whom thou hast appointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together, and to do whatsoever thy hand and thy counsel determined before to be done. And now, Lord, they said, Lord, let me tell you how great you are. Let me tell you all that you've done. And they said, Lord, we know how great you are. And in verse 29, it says, now, Lord, behold their threatenings. Oh, you know what they've said to us. And grant unto thy servants with all boldness that they may speak thy word. Why didn't they just say, Lord, you know what these evil people just said? We want to thank you for getting our friends out of prison, and we want to thank you for getting them out of this mess. But Father, we just want to be honest with you. We're a little bit scared, and we want you to protect us. Folks, I want you to know that their prayer was not self-centered, it was God-centered. It was all about God. It was telling God how great He is. They weren't praying for God to protect them, but they were praying for boldness so that they could keep preaching the Word no matter what happened to them. Folks, that's what you and I need today. We need boldness. We're afraid somebody will say something to us that we don't like, or we're afraid somebody will call us a religious fanatic, or we've gone off the deep end if we start talking to people about Jesus things. But these people were so wanting to be used of God. They said, God, you're an awesome God. Give us the boldness that we need to do what you want us to do. And you know how God answered that prayer? There was a physical shaking of the place that they were in. You know what God was doing? God said, do you want a sign of the power of God? I'll give you a sign of the power of God. And that place was physically shaken. And as that place was physically shaken, and they felt the power of God move that place, folks, every one of them were empowered by God, by the Holy Spirit, for the sake of the gospel. You know, God is a great physician, and we are commanded to pray for people that are sick. We're commanded to pray for people's needs and for people to help other people. But there's many things that we need to be praying for. But folks, listen, when most of our praying is about our wants and our needs and our concerns, you're going to see God work in your life in a small way. But when your prayer life becomes God-centered and not self-centered, you're going to see God do mighty things in your prayer life. And folks, our world today doesn't need to see the small things God can do. Our world needs to see the mighty things that God can do through His church. And the God's not going to do mighty things to his church until you and I get right with God as a church and we pray for a revival and the Spirit of God to come down upon us. Folks, our main goal is God. We're to be God-focused, God-centered, God-oriented. And we're asking him to teach us to pray so that we can show the world his power through us and his church. We need to get in tune with God. And when we get in tune with God, we're going to follow God's leadership. We're going to know God's will and we're going to follow God's will. Have you ever wondered about some of the great men in the Bible? They didn't know as much about, well, they may have known more about God than we do. I don't know. They've had the Old Testament, some of it. But have you ever wondered, take Elijah for example. Have you ever wondered how Elijah could actually expect God to respond to his prayer when Elijah said, God, here's what I want you to do. I want you to send some fire down from heaven because I've got some wood down here that's soaked in water, and I want you to send a fire down here to dry out this wood and set it on fire. How could Elijah possibly know that God would respond to that prayer? Or how about Moses? Pharaoh and his soldiers are breathing down his neck, and he's coming upon the Red Sea, and he looks back and sees the Egyptian army on one side and the mountain on the other side and the Red Sea on the other side. But he does what God tells him to do, and the Red Sea parts, and they cross safely over on the other side. What about Joshua? I was reading about Joshua the other day. Have you ever wondered how Joshua could have the boldness to stand before God and say, God, we're fighting an army right now, and God, it's getting ready to get dark, and I just need a little bit more time to defeat this army. God, could you just ask the sun to stand still for just a minute so we could have a little bit more time? Do you know why they were able to ask for those things and know that God was going to answer them? Because they believed that God could do the impossible. Because they were so God-centered and God-focused that they knew what God was doing in their life, and they knew that because God was doing in their life what it meant for their life, and they could ask for whatever they needed and God would give it to them. Remember what Elijah said before the fire fell? Elijah explained before the fire fell. He said, you know what God's doing? He's turning Israel's heart back to himself. God's at work. God's trying to turn his people's heart back to themselves. Let me tell you something. That fire fell from heaven, set that water-soaked wood on fire. He got an answer, and the people got an answer. And I believe Moses has spent a lot of private time praying to the Lord. Finally, God told him what he was going to do and how he's going to do it. And Joshua knew that God was not just with them. He knew that God was fighting with them. So he asked for some more daylight so that they could finish the job. They knew what the Lord wanted, so they asked him for it. We talked about this the other night. We don't have because we don't ask for it. Folks, I believe there's a lot of things up in God's storehouse that we don't ask for. There's a lot of victories that we could have won, but we didn't ask for what we needed to fight those battles. But here were people that knew because of the relationship they had with the Lord, because they had paid the price in spending time with him in prayer and studying his word. They understood God's perspective on their life and how God was working in their life. Folks, you and I need to understand how God's working in our life. And then we need to get involved with God. And once these people understood how God was working in their life, you know what they did? They just went about the Father's business. Well, we're coming upon the Red Sea. Don't worry about it. We're doing the Lord's business. He's going to open the Red Sea. He's going to do something. They didn't know how they were going to get across. They didn't know if God was going to build a bridge. They didn't know what was going to happen. They just knew that when they got there, God was going to get them to the other side. They knew what God wanted, so they just went about doing. Folks, if you and I know what God wants to do, why are we afraid? All we got to do is do it. God's going to take care of whatever's in front of us. Folks, you and I believe that Jesus could do everything Jesus did because he is the Son of God. Let me tell you something. He's still the Son of God. Amen. And he's still in the miracle business. But let me say this about Jesus. Even Jesus understood the connection between being self-centered and God-centered. Because even Jesus was God-centered. You say, oh, he was God's son. But in John chapter 5, verse 19 and 20, it says, Then answered Jesus and said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself. Listen. Son cannot do anything of himself, but what he seeth the Father do. He had to be focused on God. He had to know what God was doing so he could do what the Father wanted him to do. It said, For whatsoever things he doeth, there also doeth the Son likewise. For the Father loveth the Son, and showeth him all things that himself doeth. And I believe he showeth us the things that he's doing. And he will show him greater works than these, that ye may marvel. Folks, Jesus knew the heart of God. And then he acted on what was in God's heart. He walked with God, talked with God. You say, Preacher, that's common sense. He was God in the flesh, but he still had to know the will of the Father. He still had to know the heart of the Father. In the garden, he said, Father, not my will, but thy will be done. And he acted on what he knew the Father wanted him to do. And folks, he calls us to do that same kind of walk with him. God reveals his heart and his will to those who have a lifestyle of prayer and spend time with him and his word and are God-focused and are fellowshipping with him so that they'll know what God wants them to do so they can fulfill God's purposes and God's ways in their life. And then and only then, church, will we begin to see God's perspective. And listen, church, every time a church has become God-centered and God-focused and turned their heart to God in prayer, you know what God has done? He's unleashed his power upon that church. You know what Paul said his goal was in life? He said, Church, let me tell you what my goal is. He said, My goal is just to know him. And to know the power of his resurrection. And to know the fellowship of his sufferings. But you remember what else he said? And be conformed to his death. That's having a relationship with Jesus. That's walking with Jesus. And folks, that kind of relationship comes through prayer. It comes through studying your Bibles. It's time spent in the closet by yourself, but it's also time spent with your brothers and sisters in corporate prayer. And church, we need to spend more time in our closets, but church, we need to spend a whole lot more time together. We need to spend time together in confession, in repentance, in growing closer one to another, and in growing closer with the Lord. And we need to pray that this place will be shaken so that God can use us to turn our community upside down for Jesus. And somebody always says, But preacher, we're a little town and we're a little church. Let me tell you, back then, it was a little church that turned Jerusalem upside down for Jesus. And every great movement of God's got to start somewhere. And I believe a great movement of God could start here. But what's more important is that a movement of God began to work in all of God's churches so that God's people who are called by His name will all in one accord humble themselves before Him and seek His face and turn from our evil ways. He says, and then I'm going to send a great revival like you've never seen before, and I'll heal your nation. And once again, you'll be one nation under God. We'll be one in the bond of Christ. Father, bless us tonight. As we get ready to go into this time of revival, Father, we talked this morning and again tonight about how important it is to begin to make preparations tonight. And Father, if revival is going to break loose, I mean truly break loose, we're going to have to find ourselves on the altar. We're going to have to find ourselves on our knees. We're going to have to find ourselves in our prayer rooms and praying together. And we're going to have to get serious about not just prayer, but we're going to have to get serious about our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and say, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Well, I really don't know where to begin this time of invitation tonight. So I'm just going to say, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Whatever you're speaking to my heart, whatever you're speaking to every heart that's in this place, I pray that we'd move tonight as the Spirit would have us to move, and obey as the Spirit would have us to obey. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's stand if you need.